Very generic, but I will give then specific examples of what I have said. Okay. So suppose suppose the model is more complicated. Okay, then the Q device and the magnetization and energy are two different things. Okay. For instance. You can think of maybe different couplings, for instance, coupling with an external field, for instance. So the question that was put, even rigorously, was, okay, I have a space of magnetization and energy, okay? Then, okay, you know that not all values of magnetizations are possible, okay, in a model, okay? So for instance, if this is a ground state energy, suppose this is a ground state energy, for instance, you know that in the Ising model, I suppose you know the Ising model, there will be two magnetization possible, minus one and plus one, okay? Okay? Because you are on the ground state, so all the spins are either in one direction or in the other direction, so, okay, if they are plus or minus, so the magnetization can either plus or minus if it is normalized, okay? And then you know you would like to draw a curve that contains all the states of the Ising model. Okay? You would like to draw a curve that contains all the states. Okay, so, and okay, I guess it is this one. I know, because it's, so there are many, many states in the Ising model. And I would like to draw a curve that contains all the states of the Ising model. It will be more or less like this, okay? And of course, the density in this below this dome will not be uniform. Okay? For instance, if you are at very, very small energy near the ground state, you will have more states near the boundaries. You will have more states near the boundaries and less states in the middle. And as you grow, at some point, there will be more states here near zero magnetization because you are close to the transition. And then there will be no more states, OK? OK, the transition will be is not the usual transition because you are used to think of the transition in terms of temperature. Okay, here I'm in a different setting. I'm speaking about energy. So transition will be here, for instance, at some given energy. It must be within the dome, because otherwise it's not the state of the system. Okay. First of all, does this dome exist? Are there states? You can imagine that there are not states of energies if energy is it's very, very large. So there will be a boundary for this region. OK. But what is important for this type of description is that the shape of this region is convex. OK? So there cannot be non-convex shapes that delimit the region of there cannot be non-concave shape that delimit the region of accessible states in the thermodynamic limit. Why? Okay, so I will use additivity. Okay, so first of all, suppose it exists. So suppose that I have a shape like this, which is non-convex, okay? So then, that's the type of reasoning. I have, I have troubles. Okay. So suppose I have a state here, M1, E1, and I have a state here, M2, E2, okay? And now I build a chunk of matter where I put together 1 and 2 with a surface effect which is smaller and smaller as the size of the system grows. Then, I mean, you can do it even more rigorously, but you can understand very easily that if I construct the line of states that join these two points, okay, which is that line with parameter lambda, so this is the line that joins the two points, okay, which means I am distributing matter among the two parts in such a way to vary lambda, okay, then I can go for large n as close as I want to this straight line. So it means that if the system is additive, I fill the region that is inside. And in fact, I can fill the full region here with states that are obtained with this trick. Okay? It's not a proof. I'm not a mathematician, but you can understand more or less how it goes, okay? Then if you are a mathematician, you can do it and prove it as a theorem. So the space theorem, given additivity hypothesis, the state of admissible energy and magnetization in the large n limit, in the large volume limit, is bounded by a convex shape. Okay? So I will show you an example, an explicitly computable example of a spin model, analogous to the Ising model, for which we get a non-convex shape of admissible states. So we can compute explicitly the distribution, this boundary curve, and we show that it is not convex. Okay. So now it's time to be more specific about the models. I will run a little bit faster because there is no concept here. So both the models that I will study and the ones that will be studied by Nicolò fall in this class. So either we give a potential function, which is a function of the position of the particles with eventually some external field that acts on each particle, which is the case, for instance, of a self-gravitating system, so of Coulomb point charges, which will be in this category. Or, for instance, it could be an energy function where instead of having the dynamical variables move in space, they are attached to a lattice. Okay, this is, for instance, a lattice in one dimension. And then the couplings between the energy function for a pair of particles decays with distance with power half. Okay? This, for instance, is a setting which is very important for the quantum case. In fact, typically the variables that you attach to lattice are either spins or rotors, and these type of systems can be nowadays simulated in the lab. For instance, there are beautiful examples of Hamiltonians of this kind in cold ion experiments, where the particles are aligned, are trapped. The atoms are trapped, the ions are trapped, and they are put on a line. And then because of the vibration of the lattice, they couple the spins, and one can tune the interaction alpha from zero to higher values. And it's a very interesting lab for long-range interactions. Unfortunately, when this type of physics took off, I also became the director of CISA, so I had to cut down my research to essential for 6 years. And in these 6 years, there have been a tremendous development of this area of research. And I'm not aware of all what has been done in the last 6 years. So I asked Nicolò, who is an expert in this field. He has been my PhD student and is now at ETH Zurich, and he wrote also a review paper on this type of models. So I thought it was good to leave to the experts the discussion of these kind of systems. Okay, so let us make. So to finish the lecture, I have 5 minutes. Dyson died, Matteo, this year, no? Last year. So Dyson wrote this model in 69. These are Ising spins in one dimension, and they are coupled with a long-range distance. And you see, I've introduced this sigma here, okay? This alpha minus one, okay? Which I am in one dimension. Okay, so this model cannot be solved. There's no solution of this model, so if you find one, you will get a prize. After so many years, there is no solution. So we don't know the free energy, we don't know the... Okay, so I decided to study this model, but to work in a comfort zone where I can do the solution. Okay, I'm not as clever as Dyson. So so Dyson avoided to enter the region of sigma negative, okay, which is what can be called the strong long-range region, okay? Sigma was always positive, and the energy was always growing with n, we know, because if alpha is larger than d, then the energy is extensive. On the contrary, if sigma is less than zero and larger than minus one, the energy grows superlinearly with the number of particles and with the volume, with power 1 minus sigma. And now I ask my friend Mark Katz to do the scaling, and I get the free energy. Okay. So this is a very, very simple model for which I can do statmec. Okay? In this region, sigma between 0 and minus 1, which was not considered by. That's a very interesting model. I will give you an exercise on this model. One can prove that for sigma less than 1, there is a phase transition. And there's even a more interesting case, which is sigma equal 2, which corresponds to the Kondo problem studied by Phil Anderson and by Dave Thouless, where there is a Costelitz-Thouless phase, So it's a very, very rich model. But I decided to go in a region where all these Mamma Santissimas were not working, which is the sigma negative. And to do this, already you need some work. So there is a paper that I published some time ago in I think JSTATFIS, it was 15 years ago, where we could prove that I can write a functional for the magnetization, for the local magnetization of the model. So I divide the lattice in boxes, k boxes, each with n over k sides, and I introduce the box average magnetization. So I take an average over the magnetization in a box, and then I take the limit n goes to infinity with k goes to infinity, so the number of boxes goes to infinity, in such a way that k over n goes to zero. So this is called the mean field limit. Okay? Then I can prove that the n-body Hamiltonian of Dyson is one, can be written at n, the number of particles or spins, times this functional, where you see I have to do this double integral in x between 0 and 1. I normalize the lattice to 0, 1. Plus correction, which is o, small o in n, so it's is goes to 0, goes to infinity, weaker than n. Okay? So it can be neglected in the large n limit. In the large n limit, this little o n can be neglected, and you get this Hamiltonian, this function. What do I can do many things with this functional. I can study this functional, but I want to do StatMech. So what I did write an entropy for this model. And the entropy is requires a little bit of more work. One has to use large deviations. I will speak about large deviations in my lecture course. And I have an, as a result, I have an entropy functional. I have an entropy functional. Okay? So I have to be fast because, 10:45, okay? 10:45, I have 15 minutes, okay. So how do I construct this entropy functional? So first of all, I have my k boxes, and I can argue that there is a large deviation principle for the magnetization in each box. And this is the entropy of the Ising, system, 1 plus m divided by 2, 1 minus m divided by 2. This is the entropy for the Ising, you can see. And then there is no interaction. You know how statistical mechanics is built. I think Matteo can tell more important things on that. But it's based on the principle of maximum ignorance. So the thing can fluctuate as it likes. Okay, and then when you fix the constraint, you optimize the entropy given the constraint. So given the entropy of the Ising model, which is nothing but a coin toss entropy, so you coin toss the spins, and you compute the binomial distribution, you use Stirling, and you get the entropy of the Ising model. You will see, I will do an exercise on that. And you will get this entropy, okay? And in all boxes, they are independent, and there is a large deviation principle in all of the boxes. And when I do the limit, I get the exponential in n of the total entropy. And the entropy is a functional of this. Okay. So what could I could prove is that I have written here in words so that you understand, because I give reference to the papers. Maximizing entropy at fixed energy, one can obtain the magnetization profile in X. And for periodic boundary conditions, it can be proven that the variational problem is solved by a constant magnetization profile, M of X equal M. And M is obtained by solving the Curie-Weiss consistency relation, tanh of beta JM equal M. Okay, you know, everybody knows this Curie-Weiss thing. So it's tanh, and then there is a line, and magnetization is given by an intersection of the tanh with the line. So if the interaction is sufficiently long range, so if sigma equals zero, so alpha is between zero and one, I am in the so-called strong long range region, the mean field is exact for this model. The mean field is exact. And if the boundary conditions are periodic, the mean field profile is the solution in each point. And if you try to perturb this profile, so for instance, you add a Fourier mode, you add a wave, the wave will dump. This is part of the proof of stability. So the profile is constant, and if I perturb the profile, the perturbation is damped, and the optimal value is there is an open problem, still open problem. In fact, you see here it's a numerical solution. What happens if the boundary conditions are not periodic? For instance, suppose the boundary conditions are free. And so free means that the right spin will see nothing, and the left spin will see nothing. Okay, this is free boundary conditions. And I am between 0 and 1. And this is a solution that we obtained in computer simulations. Maybe it's not clear, but there are different profiles for energy 0.1, and alpha is 0.2, 0.5, and 0.8. The dotted line is the closest one to alpha equal 1, this one. And you see that the magnetization profile is not constant. So if the, and it's hard to see a constant part in this, even in the center of the magnetization profile. So it means that the solution depends on the boundary conditions. And this is no surprise at all. So I got this by optimizing the Dyson functional, so the entropy functional, at fixed energy, okay, numerically. And I see that the profile, the optimization, the optimal profile is not constant. So if you try with fixed boundary condition, also you will get that the optimal profile is not constant. So, and no one knows the value of the magnetization here. I don't have results on that. So even in this regime, and this allows me to go back to the first comment I did today. When solving the energy in a sphere, when giving a formula for the energy in a sphere, it was clear that for alpha less than d, there was an effect of the boundary, because I should have said what happens at distance r. What are the particles doing when they reach the boundary? And it will be very important what happens in the boundary for long-range interactions, because what happens in the boundary propagates in the bulk. there is no disconnection of what happens in the boundary to what happens in the bulk. So this is another difficulty of long-range interactions. Okay. Let me skip maybe this because it is... but then I will have to enter in a more difficult... Okay. So it's time for the exercises. So 5 minutes. So I prepared a few exercises, and then if you do them, you will be able to do the exam next week. Okay. It's very simple ones. It's just StatMech. So first exercise is compute the entropy and the free energy of the classical perfect gas. No interaction. So the simplest case. And show that the Legendre transform then in the next talk I will add a name. This guy Fenchel was sort of forgotten, so I will tell something about Legendre Fenchel, but for the first thing it's enough Legendre. And show that the Legendre transform of the entropy does not coincide with the free energy not coincide with the free energy at finite n. Okay. However, beta and e.
Okay. Yeah.
So the usual Legendre transformer for you can open a book in StatMech and. Ah, okay, not of the density,
of the energy.
Legendre transform in energy inverse temperature. So I will like, if you want, I can, okay. Okay, I can write it. So you have the entropy as a function of epsilon, and you have the Massier potential, which is beta, the free energy, okay? And this is Legendre. Okay, this is Legendre. Ah, yes, it's on the slides, okay. It's on the slides, yes. Beta F is beta epsilon minus S, okay. I have derived this by the Laplace method, the usual Laplace method. Okay. So, however, The functional dependence, however, the functional dependence, on beta and V, V is the volume, is the same. Check. And then, second part of the exercise, using the Stirling formula, show that they coincided large N. This is true for the perfect gas. It is true for all short-range interactions. It's not true for long-range interactions, unfortunately. This is the first exercise, exercise number one. Second exercise, exercise number two. Argue, I like exercise like this, argue. Why there cannot be phase transitions in the Ising model in 1D. With the nearest neighbor interaction. And then, second part, guess, this is very hard, I will do it, the solution in the lecture. What happens? Sorry? Ah, yes, sorry. I don't want to break everything. So argue why there cannot be phase transitions in the Ising model in 1D with nearest neighbor interaction. Guess what happens? What happens for the Dyson model? In 1D where the interaction decreases like 1 over I minus j to the 1 plus sigma for sigma larger than 0. Okay. This is the exercise. I would say this is very hard. I mean, it's a Tauless paper, or maybe. So you can try to think what happens. And this is very simple, you find in books, so if you want you can. But you have to understand, I checked in the books, there are two ways of reasoning. One way of reasoning is dynamic, so a defect is diffusing and does not attract. Another way of reasoning is static, so you look at how many defects are allowed and so on, and what is the entropy and so on. So this is, instead here you have just to write the perfect gas in a fixed volume and check. I think it's interesting because you understand something that not often you pay attention to. So the fact that you have this scheme, thermodynamic scheme of the Legendre-Fenchel transform, but at the same time, you do not have this type of equivalence at finite n. So there are finite n corrections, which are important. If you try to use it at finite energy, at finite volume, the relations are not yet in the thermodynamic limit. So you don't get what you expect. So I finish in perfect time with two exercises. Okay. So you will work out the solution tonight. Sono stato nei tempi.